Hello and welcome to Atop the Fourth Wall, where bad comics burn. It's time for another edition of Comic Book Quickies! For those just joining us, Comic Book Quickies is where we look at short stories, advertisements, and basically any comic book minutiae that's too small to make into its own episode. Except for those times when I'll do an episode on a single six-page comic. You might say that's inconsistent, but I think it's perfectly consistent with how it's my show and I'll do whatever the hell I want. So, what have we got lined up today? A short story? Hostess fruit pies? More of Spiromania? Well, let's dig into some quick comic book related material and I'll show ya! Let's start things off with a little advertisement for Super Siren, something that actually is still made based on a Google search. Super Siren by Empire. Look, after the destruction of the second Death Star, the Empire needed to make some capital, so they expanded into some new markets. It just happens sometimes. A kid, Bobby, rides his bicycle down a sidewalk but is almost hit by a car exiting out of a driveway.
Watch out, Bobby!
I'm sorry, Mr. Jones. Even though I have the right-of-way, jerkwad! His mother is none too happy about this.
Bobby, Mr. Jones told me what happened. You're punished. No more bike riding.
But I kind of needed to go to school.
That sounds like a whole lot of not my problem, Billy. Now enjoy your punishment for someone else almost running you over because they couldn't be bothered to check and see if someone was coming.
As he walks down the street, however, he passes a toy store that just happens to have a Super Siren on sale. After buying it and putting it on his bike, he shows it off to his mom.
Okay, Bobby, now you can ride your bike. Purchasing this toy has proven that you can be responsible with your bicycle.
And thus we see him blaring the thing as he passes by Mr. Jones's car again.
Good boy, Bobby. Go on and pass.
So I guess the Balrog only needed one of these things to get around Gandalf. You know, it really seems like regardless of whoever is at fault here just needs to be more attentive and not worry about loud sirens waking up the neighbors in the morning.
Kids, play it safe. Get a Super Siren for your hot cycle, trike, or bike.
Millions of people die on their tricycles without this product, kids!
And now, excerpts from the Super Dictionary with that guy with the hat. He
is my friend. That boy is my friend. And he is the thief. That man is the thief! So our main feature today, as per the 10th anniversary, is a follow-up to a bunch of stuff. First and foremost, this episode is another Comic Book Quickies. Secondly, it's a text review follow-up. Although not to the old blog, but to the Agony Booth, one of the sites that inspired me to begin with. And finally, it's a follow-up to two old episodes, my third and fourth ones in particular, Batman number 147 and the top 15 WTF moments in bad comics. Now there's a follow-up episode I should do, although admittedly, most if not all of them would be filled with stuff from Marvel. So back in 2008, nearing the end of the text review era, I had done enough work by then to get the attention of the Agony Booth and was asked to do a comic review to coincide with the release of The Dark Knight. It was suggested I do this goofy Silver Age story from Batman number 147. The comic where Batman became Bat-Baby. They were only interested in me covering that bit, so the other two Batman stories in it became my Batman number 147 review, with the Bat-Baby stuff getting covered in my top 15 WTF moments in bad comics list.
But why the hell was Bat Baby even a thing? Well, pretty simple, really. In the Silver Age, stories about a toddler Superman apparently were pretty popular, proving how desperately people needed the internet to be invented so they could have something actually entertaining to pay attention to. And the writers on Batman decided to try and see if a Bat Baby concept could work for them. The result was this thing. The cover pretty much says it all. The story of the year! Batman becomes Bat Baby! You know, if this was made in modern times, it would be the story of the year, with three tie-in miniseries leading into it, with at least two characters dying in the 8 issues of the storyline. The story opens with a splash page that's mostly a retread of the cover, although now on a rooftop, and Bat Baby is arriving thanks to him hanging onto an advertising balloon for a tire store. The criminals they're pursuing apparently decided to wear matching outfits, all in brown jackets and white fedoras. You know, it's one thing if you guys were all in ski masks or something, but apparently after this crime spree, they're all groomsmen for a guy's wedding and needed to match the color scheme.
Imagine Batman as a 4-year-old, living happily with his parents until they're brutally gunned down. Imagine Batman the size of a child, and having to overcome this handicap in order to go on fighting crime.
Okay, I have imagined it. Still seems like a terrible idea for a story.
Yes, this is exactly what occurs when Gangland takes revenge upon its greatest enemy and laughs mockingly when Batman becomes Bat Baby!
You know, a 4-year-old is really no longer a baby. Although I suppose the title Batman Becomes Bat Preschooler doesn't have quite the same punch to it. Then again, neither does Batman as a 4-year-old. Just saying, unless Alfred is still changing his diaper, perhaps Baby is pushing the description a bit far. Anyway, Batman and Robin receive a tip on a gang of jewel thieves they've been after, locating them in a warehouse. Inside of the warehouse, they not only locate the gang, but another, more fiendish villain.
Well, well, look who's part of this gang. Garth! The Renegade Scientist!
Canadian villain Garth Vader.
The Silver Age always has so much to unpack, but you've gotta love the presence of a rogue scientist, making me wonder if scientists all belong to a single union or something, who doesn't even warrant a name like Dr. Villainous or something like that. It's just Garth. To me, all that brings to mind is that Batman's opponent is played by Dana Carvey.
My archenemy, Garth! You're the one who created One-Face!
The two rush forward and attack, but Garth activates a nearby device that shoots green light at Batman.
What? An eerie ray of light! Bathing me! My god! It feels even better than herbal essences!
Yeah, just exposit that the light's hitting you, Bruce. Don't move out of the way or anything. Batman starts shrinking, and for whatever reason, the villains decide to make a run for it. That smoke bomb will hide us while we escape!
Smoke bomb!
And thus, when the smoke clears, Batman is now the size of a small, kinda chubby-cheeked child. So, this Garth guy? He has invented a device that reverses the aging process, and yet he's hanging out with jewel thieves! He is sitting on billions of dollars and could be potentially remembered as the man who gave virtual immortality to all humankind! But this is how he decides to use it! Like, even by Silver Age standards, this is unbelievably stupid and what the hell! Since his clothes haven't shrunk, although maybe they have, or else Batman is wearing very tight gloves all the time, he can't run back to the Batmobile without tripping over his own sagging costume. As such, Robin decides to carry him.
Robin, I never thought there'd be a time when you'd have to carry me in your arms like a baby, but I always dreamed there would be.
The Gotham Gazette receives photos of the baby Batman, courtesy of a camera hidden on the device. So he made sure to put a camera on it, but forgot to patent his de-aging machine. Garth, everybody! The newspaper decides to print it, instead of writing it off as a hoax. The idea behind this was to apparently humiliate Batman, but the citizenry is sympathetic.
This is terrible. Poor Batman.
Batman can't fight crime anymore now. His career is finished.
You people all have terrible priorities if that's the part you're fixating on. We then see that Alfred made sure to give the very doll-like Bruce some telephone books so that he can reach his dining room table. You know, in the Silver Age, storytelling was very compressed so that they focused on the really important stuff to talk about. Thank God I found out how Bruce is able to reach his silverware on the table. I would have found this whole thing implausible without it. Bruce trains in the Batcave and by diehard's crotch, his head is huge!
Oh, but that's not the crazy part of this panel. It turns out that along with retaining his memories, Bruce still has the strength of his adult body.
Of course! Don't you know anything about science?
After doing some training to adjust to his new body size, he unveils a new costume. I have absolutely no idea why he now needs overalls and tiny upsetting shorts for this, but there you go.
Your costume is ridiculous.
So Gangland is now calling me a baby. Well, I'll dress like a baby and prove to them that I'm still a crime fighter. As Bat Baby! Alfred, ready the Bat Pacifier!
The one you still use as an adult, sir?
Exactly!
What the hell is with the outlined lips, too? And thus we see how we got that splash page from the beginning, as Bat Baby and Robin chase some criminals. Bat Baby needing to use that tire balloon to catch some crooks on a rooftop because his tiny legs can't keep up with Robin. So his strength is retained, but not his speed. I'd argue about the logic there, but this is a comic where Batman is fighting crime as a four-year-old. Logic got beaten to death with a shovel and buried in someone's yard. After dealing with the crooks, the newspaper headlines are now talking about how Bat Baby is doing so well. Bat Baby does okay for a kid. Bat Baby overcomes size and crooks. Bat Baby in torrid affair with Kim Kardashian. Bat Baby wins World Series. Super Baby to Bat Baby, drop dead. Back at Wayne Manor, the three notice Kathy Kane coming up to the driveway for a visit. In case you've never heard of her, in the original Silver Age comics, Kathy Kane was created as a love interest for Bruce Wayne to help dispel the idea that Frederick Wortham had dreamed up in his book Seduction of the Innocent that Bruce and Dick were in a gay relationship. Kathy became Batwoman as well, and in the modern age, she was revamped as a lesbian because screw you and your crappy book, Wortham. Anyway, because of the love interest thing, they already have a plan for how to get rid of her. Which is have Alfred tell her he's in the library, and have a silhouetted shadow coming out of the library showing Bruce making out with a woman on it, and hope that she storms out in anger.
You magnificent bastard, I read your book!
Really banking on Kathy not, you know, storming in and demanding an explanation, Bruce. Also, your big plan is to make your girlfriend think you're cheating on her. World's greatest detective, everybody! And indeed, it's just a cardboard cutout.
When I'm adult size again, I'll explain that the girl she saw was a cousin. And cheating on her is just fine if it's incest.
After finding the fence for the stolen jewelry, they break into the warehouse where Garth and the gang are hiding out. For some reason, this is some kind of storage warehouse with a bunch of random objects in it, so conveniently there's a rocking horse nearby that Bat Baby rides down a flight of stairs. Well, I say stairs, but these panels seem to indicate they're actually some kind of long-ass ramp. Batman spots the device, which I guess we can call the euthanizer or whatever, and heads over to it, and I guess figures out how to make it work, because in the next panel, he's an adult again. Fortunately, we are spared the image of Batman in tiny shorts.
I discarded my Bat Baby garb and slipped on this plastic costume I had folded up in a pants pocket.
There is logic in what he says.
And so the story ends with the crooks defeated and the Bat Baby costume hung up in the trophy room.
Just a reminder of a brief childhood.
And if there's one thing that Batman likes to be reminded of, it's his childhood.
And now, excerpts from the Super Dictionary with that guy with the hat. Invisible.
Conjura has made you an invisible person. She has made you a person who cannot be seen.
Look in the mirror.
Let's end this one with that old standard, the Hostess Fruit Pie comic.
Superman in the Ionic Storm.
An ion storm, eh? I had to deal with one of those once. Wasn't a big deal. Superman is flying through space, as you do.
An ion cloud, filled with miniature meteors, one of the most dangerous natural forces in this galaxy. At least, that's what I tell my insurance company anyway.
Using his telescopic vision, he spots something in the path of the storm.
Great Krypton! A party of picnickers on planetoid RM! We should probably come up with better names for planetoids if we're gonna have people have picnics on them.
Just gotta love random human picnickers on a planetoid! I mean, I assume they're human. Kryptonians look like humans, so maybe like dozens of other alien species look like us too. Anyway, Superman sees that the planetoid is right in the path of the ion storm.
Well, that problem is over there, and those picnickers over there need to take care of it themselves. Man, even in deep space I'm referencing that. Why am I even a superhero?
And that ion storm must really hate this family in particular because it goes right for them. Fortunately, Superman gets right in the path of it, the meteorites inside of it harmlessly bouncing off of him as the cloud disintegrates.
You saved us, Superman! Just in time for a super dessert! Apple and cherry hostess fruit pies!
My god! That's why the ion storm was after them! It wanted the fruit pies! No, but seriously, that's the part where they bring in the fruit pies? Come on, you could have at least said that Superman got energy from the things that would allow him to stop the ion storm. Instead, it's just, hey, we're random space picnickers who happen to have fruit pies. What a load. They invite him to stay and have some.
I'm already way overdue back on Earth. Have some for me.
Villains are willing to kill for those things, Superman. You'd better eat one.
Being rescued by Superman is almost as much fun as hostess fruit pies.
Our lives are worth less than this cheap confectionery. Yeah, it's always weird coming across a fruit pie comic like this one. What's even the point? It's a lazy advertisement just showing off a superhero doing something heroic, but the fruit pies contribute nothing to the story of the ad. I mean, I know it's ridiculous that these things could stop evildoers by simply being offered to them, but at least it's part of the narrative. If you're not gonna bother making them part of the story, why even bother with the rest of the plot? So, we have learned this week that children are at fault if someone runs them over, but it's okay if those children are actually adults who have been transformed into hideous not babies. Also, if you're invisible, look in the mirror and see if your hat was stolen. Or something like that. Anyway, next week, 500th episode! See you then.
According to this letter, Garth had a camera hidden in his machine, and it photographed Batman. Much as I hate to do it, I must print these photos. The public has a right to the truth.
I'd never be deceptive to the public, or my name isn't J. Jonah Jameson.